Today we shall study a very important subject, and that is the sealing of God's people. This subject is recorded both in the Old and New Testaments. Whether we understand the subject or not, whether we believe in the subject or not, the fact is that it has to do something with every one of us. A statement which is found in Testimonies for the Church, volume 5, page 212, reads, "Our own course of action will determine whether we shall receive the seal of the living God or be cut down by the destroying weapons. Our destiny depends on this, whether we shall receive the seal of the living God or not." As we mentioned, this subject is recorded both in the Old and New Testaments. In the Old Testament, we read in Ezekiel chapter 9 about this message. Ezekiel chapter 9. But before we read Ezekiel 9, let us read Ezekiel chapter 8, because this is an introduction to chapter 9. Therefore, because this chapter is not so long, let us read the whole chapter. Ezekiel chapter 8. "And it came to pass in the sixth year of the sixth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I sat in mine house, and the elders of Judah sat before me, that the hand of the Lord fell there upon me. Then I beheld, and lo, a likeness as the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his loins even downward fire, and from his loins even upward, as the appearance of brightness, as the color of amber. And he put forth the form of an hand, and took me by a lock of mine head. And the Spirit lifted me up between the earth and the heaven, and brought me in the visions of God to Jerusalem, to the door of the inner gate that looketh toward the north, where was the seat of the image of jealousy, which provoketh to jealousy. And behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there, according to the vision that I saw in the plain. Then said he unto me, Son of man, lift up thine eyes now the way toward the north. So I lifted up mine eye the way toward the north, and behold, northward at the gate of the altar, this image of jealousy in the entry. He said furthermore unto me, Son of man, seest thou what they do, even the great abominations that the house of Israel committeth here, that I should go far off from my sanctuary? But turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations. And he brought me to the door of the court, and when I looked, behold, a hole in the wall. Then said he unto me, Son of man, dig now in the wall. And when I had digged in the wall, behold, a door. And he said unto me, Go in and behold the wicked abominations that they do there. So I went in and saw, and behold, every form of creeping things and abominable beasts, and all the idols of the house of Israel portrayed upon the wall round about. And there stood before them 70 men of the ancients of the house of Israel, And in the midst of them stood Jezaniah, the son of Shaphan, with every man his censer in his hand. And the thick cloud of incense went up. Then said he unto me, Son of man, hast thou seen what the ancients of the house of Israel do in the dark, every man in the chambers of his imagery? For they say, The Lord seeth us not. The Lord hath forsaken the earth. He said unto me, Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations that they do. Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north. And behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. Then said he unto me, Hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations than these. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men, with their backs toward the temple of the Lord, and their faces toward the east, and they worshipped the sun toward the east. Then he said unto me, Hast thou seen this, O son of man? Is it a light thing to the house of Judah that they commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have filled the land with violence and have returned to provoke me to anger. And lo, they put the branch to their nose. Therefore will I also deal in fury. Mine eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity. And though they cry in mine ears with a loud voice, yet will I not hear them. In this chapter 8 of Ezekiel, we find abominations upon abominations. And the Lord said to the prophet, You will see greater abomination than this, until we came to the greatest abomination. And what was it? Turning the backs to the temple of God and their faces towards the east, worshiping the sun. This was the greatest abomination. Notice carefully, sun worship is the greatest abomination. S-U-N. We should be sun worshippers, yes. S-O-N. The Son of God, we should worship Him. But not S-U-N, the sun. And sun worship has something to do with Sunday worship, which we will consider towards the end of our study. When the prophet saw all this, the Lord showed him further vision, which is recorded in chapter 9. And now we are going to read chapter 9 of Ezekiel. He cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, Cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, every man with his destroying weapons in his hand. And behold, 6 came from the way of the higher gate, which lieth toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one man among them was clothed with linen, with a writer's ink horn by his side. And they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub whereupon he was to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's ink horn by his side, And the Lord said unto him, Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And to the others he said in mine hearing, Go ye after him through the city, and smite. Let not your eye spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women. But come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. And he said unto them, Defile the house, and fill the courts with the slain. Go ye forth. And they went forth and slew in the city. And it came to pass, while they were slaying them, and I was left, that I fell upon my face, and cried, and said, O Lord, wilt thou destroy all the residue of Israel in thy pouring out of thy fury upon Jerusalem? Then said he unto me, The iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceeding great, and the land is full of blood, and the city full of perverseness. For they say, The Lord has forsaken the earth, and the Lord seeth not. And as for me also, mine eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity, but I will recompense their way upon their head. And behold, the man clothed with linen, which had the inkhorn by his side, reported the matter, saying, I have done as thou hast commanded me. Here in this chapter 9 of Ezekiel, it is recorded that those that were sighing and crying for the abominations that were committed in Jerusalem, they should receive a mark in their foreheads. And those who did not have this mark, they were destroyed by those men having the destroying weapons in their hands. And when the prophet saw this utter destruction, he asked the Lord, Lord, will you destroy also Israel and the remnant of Israel? The Lord said, The iniquity of the house of Israel is great, exceedingly. They say, The Lord has forsaken the earth, the Lord does not see. And then the Lord said, As for me, I will not spare them. However, in our study today, we will see that the remnant of Israel, they had the mark in their foreheads, and they were not destroyed. Further in our study, we will come back to this chapter 9 of Ezekiel. But now, let us see in the New Testament the description of this same sealing work. And this is recorded in the 7th chapter of the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 7. And we read from verses 1 to verse 4. And after these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels, to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, Hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed. And they were sealed, 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. In this chapter 7 of Revelation, we find a description of the same work of sealing. Testimonies to Ministers, page 445, tells us that this sealing that John witnessed and described in Revelation chapter 7 is the same that Ezekiel had seen in vision. So this work of sealing, both in Ezekiel and in Revelation, is the same work. We have to consider now these verses in Revelation chapter 7. The Bible commences with these words: "After these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds on the earth." In Ezekiel, there were six men with slaughtering weapons. Here we have four angels holding the four winds. This sealing, or this holding of the winds, is very important. And winds in the Bible may represent false doctrines, but in this case, it represents something else. It represents wars, revolutions, political commotions. And as it is recorded in Testimonies to Ministers, page 444, and I'm going to read Testimonies to Ministers, page 444. John sees the elements of nature, earthquake, tempest, and political strife represented as being held by four angels. Notice carefully, these winds represent elements of nature, earthquake, tempest, but also represent political strife. These winds are under control until God gives the word to let them go. There is the safety of God's church. The angels of God do His bidding, holding back the winds of the earth, that the winds should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree, until the servants of God should be sealed in their foreheads. The Bible tells us also, in many places, the winds represent political strife. One example we have in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 51, verses 1 and 2, which reads, "Thus says the Lord, Behold, I will raise up against Babylon, and against them that dwell in the midst of them that rise up against me, a destroying wind, and will send unto Babylon fanners that shall fan her and shall empty her land. For in the day of trouble they shall be against her round about." Also, in Jeremiah chapter 25, verse 32, and Jeremiah chapter 49, verse 36, and Daniel chapter 7, verse 2. All these verses speak about winds blowing, which represent political movements or political strife. In early writings, I wish to read on page 38. Early writings, page 38. "I saw four angels who had a work to do on the earth and were on their way to accomplish it. Jesus was clothed with priestly garments. He gazed in pity on the remnant, then raised his hands, and with a voice of deep pity cried, "My blood, Father, my blood, my blood, my blood." Then I saw an exceeding bright light come from God, who sat upon the great white throne and was shed all about Jesus. Then I saw an angel with a commission from Jesus swiftly flying to the four angels who had a work to do on the earth and waving something up and down in his hand and crying with a loud voice, "Hold, hold, 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 until the servants of God are sealed in their foreheads." I asked my accompanying angel the meaning of what I heard and what was the four angels about to do. He said to me that it was God that restrained the powers and that he gave his angels charge over things on earth, that the four angels had power from God to hold the four winds, and that they were about to let them go, but while their hands were loosening and the four winds were about to blow, the merciful eye of Jesus gazed on the remnant that were not sealed, and he raised his hands to the Father and pleaded with him that he had spilled his blood for them. Then another angel was commissioned to fly swiftly to the four angels and bid them hold until the servants of God were sealed with the seal of the living God in their foreheads. Here is given a detail about the work of these four angels that were holding the winds. Jesus commanded them to hold the winds by the message of this other angel flying swiftly to them and saying, "Hold the winds, that they should not blow until we will seal the foreheads of our servants, of the servants of God." Interesting that this statement here, when we read from the Present Truth, Volume 1, Number 3, there is one word that was omitted in early writings. And I'm going to read one sentence here from the Present Truth, Volume 1, Number 3. The same paragraph, but one word was left out. And I'm going to read this statement. While they had started on their mission to let them go, the merciful eye of Jesus gazed on the remnant that were not all sealed. The word "all" is omitted in early writings. And what is the difference? The difference is that if I say they were not all sealed, that indicates that some have been sealed already. But if we read simply "they were not sealed," you can have the idea that the sealing is still a future event. It is interesting that this message was given in the early days of the Advent movement. And this is why we believe that this is historic message of the sealing. In the same book, Present Truth, Volume 1, Number 4, it is stated the following: "The Lord has shown me that precious souls are starving and dying for want of the present sealing truth, the meat in due season, and the swift messengers should speed on their way and feed the flock with the present truth. The present truth in the early days of the Advent movement after 1844, yes, the present truth was the sealing truth. And this message was considered a life or death message. And the angel said, speed the swift messengers, because the destiny of every soul will soon be decided. And it was very well known that the sealing message was the present truth at that time. We already noticed and considered the four winds that were held back until the servants of the Lord would be sealed in their foreheads. Now we shall consider that other angel that had the seal of the living God in his hand. Who is that sealing angel? In early writings, pages 88 and 89, we read, I saw a little company traveling in narrow pathway. All seemed to be firmly united, bound together by the truth in bundles or companies. Said the angel, the third angel is binding or sealing them in bundles for the heavenly garner. According to this statement, the sealing angel, or that angel that had the seal of the living God in his hand, is the third angel of Revelation chapter 14, verses 9 to 13. Another statement taken also from the book Early Writings, page 118. I then saw the third angel, said my accompanying angel, fearful is his work, awful is his mission. He is the angel that is to select the wheat from the tares and seal or bind the wheat for the heavenly garner. These things should engross the whole mind, the whole attention. Again, the third angel is introduced here as the sealing angel. He is the angel that is to bind together or seal the servants of the living God for the heavenly garner. Another statement taken from Testimonies to Ministers 444 reads, the mighty angel is seen ascending from the east, or sunrising. This mightiest of angels has in his hand the seal of the living God, or of him who alone can give life, who can inscribe upon the foreheads the mark or inscription to whom shall be granted immortality, eternal life. In this statement, it is mentioned again that the sealing angel is one of the mightiest of the angels. And this angel is the third angel. The third angel has the seal of the living God in his hand. And now we shall consider what is the seal of the living God. The word seal, mark, or stamp mean the same thing. We find in the Bible the description of the Sabbath as being the seal of the living God. For example, in Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 20, we read, "And hallow my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign between me and you, that ye may know that I am the Lord your God." Also, in verse 12, we read, "Moreover also I gave them my Sabbaths, to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctify them." But here, we read about the word sign. We do not read the word mark. One statement from the Spirit of Prophecy, Testimonies for the Church, Volume 8, page 117, clarifies this point. And we read, "The sign or seal of God is revealed in the observance of the seventh day Sabbath, the Lord's memorial of creation." The Sabbath is the seal of the living God, or the mark of the living God, or the sign of the living God. In the book The Great Controversy, page 452, we read this: "The seal of God's law is found in the fourth commandment. This only of all the ten brings to view both the name and the title of the lawgiver. It declares him to be the creator of the heavens and the earth, and thus shows his claim to reverence and worship above all others. Aside from this precept, there is nothing in the Decalogue to show by whose authority the law is given." This statement tells us clearly that the seal of the living God is found in the fourth commandment, or the fourth commandment is the seal. And a part of that commandment, there is nothing in the law that can tell us who is the lawgiver. If we analyze the Ten Commandments one by one, for example, the first commandment, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me," that commandment does not say who is that God. If we examine the second commandment that forbids worshiping God through images or to worship images directly, does not tell us either who is the lawgiver. If we look to the third commandment, "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain," it doesn't say either who is the lawgiver. Well, we skip the fourth commandment and we go to the fifth, the sixth, the seventh, the eighth, the ninth, the tenth commandment. None of them tell us who is the lawgiver. In a sign or a stamp or a signature, three important elements must be found. One is the name of the lawgiver. Second, his authority. And third is the territory of his dominion. If we take the fourth commandment out of the law, we don't know who is the author of that law. Who is the lawgiver? For example, if we take a native of any land who does not know the Bible, he does not know the holy law of God, and he set up a rock and he says, that is my God. And if we disconsider the fourth commandment, then we cannot prove him wrong. He says, well, I have no other gods before this rock. And we examine all nine commandments. We do not have any evidence there to say to this man that he is wrong. But now, if we turn to the fourth commandment, the fourth commandment tells us the name of the lawgiver, the Lord your God. And what is his authority? His power. His power is, he is the creator of the heavens, the earth, and all things that in them is. And all this is his territory of dominion. Now, we can tell this native that he is wrong, that God is in this earth, that his God, that rock, is not the true God. Because the true God created everything that is on earth. If we take the fourth commandment out, the law is not authentic, does not bear the signature of the lawgiver. And for that reason, both the Bible and the spirit of prophecy tell us clearly that the fourth commandment is the seal of the living God. It is suggested that natives in any land or islands, using their power of thinking, could develop a code similar to the nine commandments, just using their reasoning capabilities. But they could never, by reasoning, come to the conclusion that they have to keep the seventh day of the week. This they will know only when they find out written in God's word. This is why it is very important for us to know that the Sabbath is a seal of the living God. And the third angel has the seal of the living God in his hand. He is sealing the servants of God. One important point is that this message of the third angel is not only pointing to the seal of the living God, but warning the inhabitants of the earth against receiving another seal or another mark. And as a result of his work, the third angel points to a people that have the patience of the saints, that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. Revelation chapter 14, verse 12. Now a question, when did this sealing war begin? Or did not yet commence? To answer this question, we should ask, when did the third angel begin his work? All Sabbath keepers, all Adventists know undoubtedly that the third angel began his work in 1844. And since 1844, the sealing work is in progress. In early writings, on page 43, we read this. And this was written in 1849, March 24, 1849. Satan is now using every device in this sealing time to keep the minds of God's people from the present truth and cause them to waver. Notice that in 1849, the servant of the Lord says, this sealing time. And on page 44, it is stated further, I saw that Satan was at work in these ways to distract, deceive, and draw away God's people just now in this sealing time. I saw some who were not standing stiffly for present truth. Their knees were trembling and their feet sliding because they were not firmly planted on the truth. And the covering of Almighty God could not be drawn over them while they were thus trembling. Satan was trying his every art to hold them where they were until the sealing was passed, until the covering was drawn over God's people, and they left without a shelter from the burning wrath of God in the seven last plagues. God has begun to draw this covering over his people, and it will soon be drawn over all who are to have a shelter in the day of slaughter. The seal is a sign of protection. It is a covering that God was standing over his people. And in 1849, it was stated that Satan was at work at that very time. And it stated in this sealing time to keep the people away from the present truth so that the covering may be extended or drawn over God's people and they will be left without a shelter in the time of slaughter. On page 58 in early writings, we read, early writings, page 58. The sealing time is very short and will soon be over. Now is the time, while the four angels are holding the four winds, to make our calling and election sure. Instead of saying that the sealing time soon will commence, it says that the sealing time soon will be over. And the early Adventists, they believed that this message, the sealing message, was the present truth. The sealing work has begun already since 1844. And the Seventh-day Adventist Church began the work of publication as a result of the vision on the sealing work. I want to read from Life Sketches, page 125, the following. At a meeting held in Dorchester, Massachusetts, November 1848, I had been given a view of the proclamation of the sealing message and of the duty of the brethren to publish the light that was shining upon our pathway. After coming out of vision, I said to my husband, I have a message for you. You must begin to print a little paper and send it out to the people. Let it be small at first, but as the people read, they will send you means with which to print, and it will be a success from the first. From this small beginning, it was shown to me to be like streams of light that went clear around the world. The publishing work commenced as a result of the vision of the ceiling work. And on the first page of the first edition of the magazine, The Present Truth, was an article published by James White. And that article dealt with the Sabbath as beginning at creation, not at Sinai. And it was considered by the early Adventists that this question of the sealing of God's people is a doctrinal question. It was a doctrine. And it is written on page 127 of Life Sketches. I will read Life Sketches, page 127. With the beginning of this work of publishing, we did not cease our labors in preaching the truth, but traveled from place to place proclaiming the doctrines which had brought so great light and joy for us, encouraging the believers, correcting errors, and setting things in order in the church. We noticed here the expression, we went from place to place proclaiming the doctrines which had brought so great light and joy for us. It was a doctrinal issue. And the early Adventists, they believed that all those who faithfully kept the Sabbath, they were sealed. For example, in Selected Messages, Book 2, page 263, Ellen White is writing a letter to a brother whose wife had passed away. And this is what she says. Dear brother, I hardly know what to say to you. The news of your wife's death was to me overwhelming. I could hardly believe it and can hardly believe it now. God gave me a view last Sabbath night, which I will write. I saw that she was sealed and would come up at the voice of God and stand upon the earth and would be with the 144,000. I saw we need not mourn for her. She would rest in the time of trouble. And all that we could mourn for was our loss in being deprived of her company. This message to this brother was given in 1852. And three important points should be noticed in this message. She was sealed. This is one point. The second point, she will come up at the voice of God. And the third point, she would be with the 144,000. This was the belief of the early Seventh-day Adventists. And this doctrine was believed for many decades, until the year 1894. In 1894, there was a brother who presumed to have new light on this question. And he published a little booklet called The 144,000 Sealed. And in that message, he introduced the idea that the 144,000 would be made up only of those who had never died. One of the pioneers, John Loughborough, says the following when he read that little booklet, the 144,000 sealed. He says this in his booklet, Questions on the Sealing Message. Right in the introduction, he says, and I quote, "In reference to the subject matter of this book, the sealed 144,000, I have been greatly moved by the Spirit of God to write and publish the facts as to how the sealing message was obtained, not only from the Bible, but by direct instruction in vision of Sister A.G. White. Also, as to how the message was received and taught by our ministers and people down to the year 1894, when the New Light theory found its advocate in one who afterward apostatized from the faith and died without seeing the fulfillment of his expectation that he would live to the end of time and hence be one of the 144,000. His claim was that later testimonies of Sister White taught that all the 144,000 would be made up of those who had never died. When Loughborough, he heard this message and this new light, he thought that it was time for him to write and explain how the Adventist believed and taught this sealing of the 144,000. And Ellen White speaks about that man that's supposed to have new light in Selected Messages, Book 2, page 113. Selected Messages, Book 2, 113. "The hardest task I ever had to do in this line was in dealing with one who I knew wanted to follow the Lord. For some time he had thought he was obtaining new light. He was very ill and must soon die. And oh, how my heart hoped he would not make it necessary for me to tell him just what he was doing. Those to whom he presented his views listened to him eagerly, and some thought him inspired. He had a chart made and reasoned from the scriptures to show that the Lord would come at a certain date, in 1894, I think. To many, his reasoning seemed to be without a flaw. They told of his powerful exhortations in his sick room. Most wonderful views passed before him. But what was the source of his inspiration? It was the morphine given him to relieve his pain. At our camp meeting at Lansing, Michigan, just before I came to Australia, I had to speak plainly in regard to this new light. I told the people that the words they had heard were not the truth of inspiration. The wonderful light, which presented such a show of truth, was the result of a misapplication of Scripture. The Lord's work would not close up in 1894. The word of the Lord to me was, this is not truth, but will lead into strange paths, and some will become confused over this representation and will give up the faith." This man had new light, was inspired. But what was the source of his inspiration? The Spirit of Prophecy tells us that was the morphine given him to relieve his pains. And the spirit of prophecy tells us that that was not the truth. That representation or that new light would lead many astray into strange paths. The Seventh-day Adventist Church did not accept this new light immediately, because later Elder H.R. Johnson published in the Review and Herald a long article of 36 points on June 27, 1905. And what he published here was exactly what the Adventists believed from the very beginning, and that is exactly what we believe today. In the German Sabbath lesson in 1908, a note appeared also declaring that the 144,000 will be made up of the living and those who have died in the faith of the third angel's message. And until World War I, there was no doubt among the Adventists about the doctrine of the 144,000 that this would be made up of the living and those who have died faithfully in the message. But after World War I, the doctrine had to be restudied because the membership passed that number of 144,000. And now they had to introduce some new explanation about the doctrine. And among many different opinions, is not a doctrinal issue in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but among the many opinions, two are mostly upheld. One is that the 144,000 is a symbolic number. The other view is that the 144,000 will be made up of those who have never died. These are the two most important positions of members of Seventh-day Adventist Church. But the church itself does not hold this point as a doctrinal issue. But we are more interested to see not what one may believe or another believe, but what does the Bible and the spirit of prophecy say about this issue. As we have seen before, the sealing work has commenced and is in progress. And our attention is asked, how long will the sealing message continue? In early writings on page 36, I read a statement. Early writings, page 36. I saw that the four angels would hold the four winds until Jesus' work was done in the sanctuary, and then will come the seven last plagues. In Revelation chapter 7, we read that the angels will hold the winds until the servants of God are sealed in their foreheads. And here it says that the angels hold the winds until Jesus' work is finished in the heavenly sanctuary. In the same book, Early Writings, on page 279, we read this. I saw angels hurrying to and fro in heaven. An angel with the writer's ink horn by his side returned from the earth and reported to Jesus that his work was done, and the saints were numbered and sealed. Then I saw Jesus, who had been ministering before the ark, containing the Ten Commandments, throw down the censer. He raised his hands and with a loud voice said, "It is done." And all the angelic host laid off their crowns as Jesus made the solemn declaration, "He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still." In this statement says clearly that the sealing will be finished when Jesus' work is done, and then probation closes. And then, as we have read on page 36, will come the seven last plagues. All those who were faithful, they received the seal of the living God. In a great controversy, page 613, this is what we read. An angel returning from the earth announces that his work is done, the final test has been brought upon the world, and all who have proved themselves loyal to divine precepts have received the seal of the living God. Then Jesus ceases his intercession in the sanctuary above. All faithful receive the seal before probation closes. And after probation closes, the winds will blow. And we remember the statement in Testimonies to Ministers, page 444. It says that those winds represent elements of nature and political strife. And in the elements of nature, she mentioned tempest and earthquakes. Let us examine the seven last plagues, which is described in the book of Revelation chapter 16. The first plague, as it is recorded in Revelation chapter 16, verse 2, the first plague was poured out upon those who had the mark of the beast, or upon those who had not received the seal of the living God. And this plague is a noisome and grievous sore. Who received this plague? Those that had the mark of the beast. Is this sore element of nature, or is that a political strife? Certainly, it is an element of nature. Now, the second plague, in verse 3, the second plague is poured out upon the sea, and the sea became as blood. But the Bible says became as blood of a dead man. And you just imagine, what is it like, the blood of a dead man? Every living soul died in the sea. Is that element of nature, or is that a political strife? Again, it is an element of nature. The third plague, in verse 4, the angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and the fountains of waters, and they became blood. And now notice that now not only the sea, but rivers and fountains of waters, they became blood. This is also element of nature. What about the fourth plague? In verse 8, the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and power was given unto him to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat, and blasphemed the name of God, which hath power over these plagues. And they repented not to give him glory. The sun scorching men with great heat. This is also element of nature. But notice that these four plagues mentioned thus far are not universal. This is written in Great Controversy, page 628. Great Controversy 628, after the description of the fourth plague. These plagues are not universal, or the inhabitants of the earth would be wholly cut off. Yet they will be the most awful scourges that have ever been known to mortals. Therefore, the sea was transformed into blood, but not everywhere. The rivers and fountains of waters were transformed into blood, not everywhere. The sores were poured out upon those who had the mark of the beast. But these plagues are not universal. And the sun was scorching men with fire, and not everywhere. Because of the statement that says that these plagues are not universal. Yet, they are awful scourges that have ever been known to mortals. Now we go to the fifth plague. In Revelation chapter 16, verses 10 and 11. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the seat of the beast. And his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain, and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds. The fifth plague is the plague of darkness, and this will be poured out upon the seat of the beast. An important part here is that they had sores, and they were gnashing their teeth because of the sores they had. But it's interesting that darkness itself does not cause pain. If the lights are switched off in this very moment, none of us will feel pain, because we are in darkness. But they felt pain because of the source. So when did they receive those sores? In the first plague. From this we deduct that the plagues are cumulatives. And again, this plague of the darkness is element of nature. Now, the sixth plague, in one word, what is the sixth plague? In verse 16, Armageddon. Armageddon. In the seventh plague, we read in verses 17 and 18, and the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne, saying, it is done. And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. This seventh plague, which is earthquake, and in verse 21 speaks also about hailstorm. Also, this plague is element of nature, which is the only one that is political strife. Only the sixth. And with the six begins the war of Armageddon. And that's the only one political strife in the seven plagues. But we want now to comment what occurs during the seventh plague. In Great Controversy, we read on page 636, Great Controversy 636. It is at midnight that God manifests his power for the deliverance of his people. The sun appears shining in strength, signs and wonders follow in quick succession. The wicked look with terror and amazement upon the scene, while the righteous behold with solemn joy the tokens of their deliverance. Everything in nature seems turned out of its course. The streams cease to flow. Dark, heavy clouds come up and clash against each other. In the midst of the angry heavens is one clear space of indescribable glory, whence comes the voice of God like the sound of many waters, saying, "It is done." In this reading, we find a very important event taking place. At midnight, the sun appears and it shines in its brightness, full brightness at midnight. How could that be? Some may suggest to me that it is a mistake stating that the sun at midnight will shine in its brightness. Well, let us read a similar Bible verse in Amos chapter 8, verse 9. Amos 8:9. And it shall come to pass in that day, says the Lord God, that I will cause the sun to go down at noon, and I will darken the earth in the clear day. Here the Bible says that at noon the sun will go down. In a great controversy we read that at midnight the sun will shine in its splendor. How can this be? It's very simple. The earth will turn upside down. Where it was midday, became midnight. Where it was midnight, become midday. It's in full harmony with the Bible. Why is it that at midnight that God's voice is uttered, saying it is done, at the beginning of the seventh plague? Why it is at midnight? Because the wicked assigned a day to slaughter the commandment-keeping people of God. And in the worldly reckoning, the day begins at midnight. And when the midnight comes, they are ready to go to exterminate the Sabbath keepers. But then a phenomenon takes place. The earth turns upside down. And here the spirit of prophecy says, the wicked look with terror and amazement upon the scene. They don't know whether that midday is the previous day or the following day. But the righteous, they know it's a sign of their deliverance. We read in continuation in Great Controversy, same page, 636. That voice shakes the heavens and the earth. There is a mighty earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. Verses 17 and 18 of Revelation 16. You noticed here that the voice of God, when he says, it is done, that voice shakes heaven and earth. There is an earthquake. And what happens in that earthquake? On page 637, we read, Great Controversy 637, graves are opened, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. All who have died in the faith of the third angel's message come forth from the tomb glorified to hear God's covenant of peace with those who have kept his law. They also which pierced him, those that mocked and derided Christ's dying agonies, and the most violent opposers of his truth and his people, are raised to behold him in his glory and to see the honor placed upon the loyal and obedient. In that earthquake, graves are opened and there is a resurrection. The spirit of prophecy quotes here Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. This resurrection in the beginning of the seventh plague is not the resurrection of all righteous, neither the resurrection of all wicked. Because the Bible says that some will come up to everlasting life, some to everlasting contempt. Those who come up in the first resurrection, all of them, they are blessed and holy. Revelation chapter 20, verse 6. Blessed and holy is he that has part on the first resurrection. So those who are resurrected in the first general resurrection, they are all blessed and are all holy. But this resurrection of Daniel 12:2 is partly righteous and partly wicked. Therefore, it is a partial resurrection. And who are the righteous that will be raised from their tombs in the beginning of the seventh plague? We have read here, all who have died in the faith of the third angel's message, not some, but all who have died in the faith, they will be resurrected at the partial resurrection. How are they resurrected? We read here, they are glorified. What is the purpose of their resurrection? To hear God's covenant of peace with those who have kept his law. And what about those that are wicked? Those that are resurrected for everlasting contempt? In Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, we read that every eye shall see him coming, even those that pierced him. And here we have read that not only those that pierced Jesus, but the most violent opposers of his truth and his people, they will be resurrected in that partial resurrection. After this resurrection, on page 639, Great Controversy, we read, then there appears against the sky, hand holding two tables of stone folded together, says the prophet, the heavens shall declare his righteousness, for God is judge himself. That holy law, God's righteousness, that amid thunder and flame was proclaimed from Sinai as the guide of life is now revealed to men as the rule of judgment. The hand opens the table, and there are seen the precepts of the Decalogue, traced as with pen of fire. The words are so plain that all can read them. Memory is aroused. The darkness of superstition and heresy is swept from every mind. And God's 10 words, brief, comprehensive, and authoritative, are presented to the view of all the inhabitants of the earth. After the partial resurrection, the 10 commandments will be displayed in the sky. And everyone will see the 10 commandments. 10 words, brief, comprehensive, and authoritative. And the next paragraph says, it is impossible to describe the horror and despair of those who have trampled upon God's holy requirement. And on page 640, we read, the enemies of God's law, from the ministers down to the least among them, have a new conception of truth and duty. Too late, they see that the Sabbath of the fourth commandment is the seal of the living God. Yes, after the partial resurrection, when the 10 commandments will be displayed in the heavens, ministers and people who transgressed God's law, they will see now, but it's too late. They see that the Sabbath of the fourth commandment is the seal of the living God. Now, after this event, something else will happen. On the same page, 640, Great Controversy, we read, Great Controversy 640, the voice of God is heard from heaven, declaring the day and the hour of Jesus' coming, and delivering the everlasting covenant to his people. After the display of the Ten Commandments in heaven, and that is well after the partial resurrection, the voice of God is heard from heaven, and now he declares the day and hour of Jesus' coming, and delivering the everlasting covenant. Those that have died in the faith of the third angel's message, they were raised to hear this covenant of peace. And now they know the day and hour of Jesus' coming. The same event is described here in early writings, page 15. Soon we heard the voice of God like many waters, which gave us the day and hour of Jesus' coming. The living saints, 144,000 in number, knew and understood the voice, while the wicked thought it was thunder and an earthquake. This statement here is very important. To me, this is a key to understand the message of the sealing of the 144,000. When the voice of God announces the day and hour of Jesus' coming, there are two classes of people on earth: the living saints and the wicked. No others. Only the living saints and the wicked. The living saints are 144,000 in number. Now here, you cannot interpret that this is a symbolic number. I read again, the living saints, 144,000 in number. But many times I ask this question, how many living persons on earth heard the voice of God? And I receive immediately an answer, 144,000. And this is not so. Every living person on earth heard the voice of God. The difference is that 144,000 understood the voice of God. The others also heard, but they thought it was a thunder or earthquake. And who are they? The spirit of prophecy says that they are wicked. And therefore, there is no other class. Only the 144,000 saints, 144,000 in number, and the wicked. And the question now comes up. Where are the faithful Adventists that were raised in the partial resurrection? They must be among either of these two companies. They are either included in the 144,000 or they are wicked. Therefore, we believe that those only who have the seal of the living God, they will be protected in the time of slaughter. And as Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 6 tells us, all those who had not the seal, they were slaughtered by the slaughtering weapons. After they hear the voice of God from heaven, they look up. And then they see in the east a small black cloud. I'm reading Great Controversy 6:40. It is the cloud which surrounds the Savior and which seems in the distance to be shrouded in darkness. The people of God know this to be the sign of the Son of Man. In solemn silence they gaze upon it as it draws nearer the earth, becoming lighter and more glorious, until it is a great white cloud, its base a glory like consuming fire, and above it the rainbow of the covenant. The same description is given also in early writings. On page 16, in his right hand was a sharp sickle, in his left a silver trumpet. Jesus will come, and he has in his right hand a sharp sickle, which is a symbol of harvest, and in his left hand a silver trumpet. And the next paragraph says, then Jesus' silver trumpet sounded as he descended on the cloud wrapped in flames of fire. He gazed on the graves of the sleeping saints, then raised his eyes and hands to heaven and cried, awake, 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 ye that sleep in the dust, and arise. Then there was a mighty earthquake. The graves opened, and the dead came up clothed with immortality. The 144,000 shouted hallelujah as they recognized their friends who had been torn from them by death. And in the same moment we were changed and caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. Let us notice carefully the difference between the partial resurrection and the general resurrection of all righteous. At the partial resurrection, God says, it is done. It is finished. The last plague is poured out. And that voice of God shakes heaven and earth and occurs the partial resurrection. But now, when Jesus comes, his silver trumpet sounds, he gazes in the graves, on the graves of the saints, sleeping saints, and then calls them, awake, awake, awake. And they come up clothed with immortality. The Apostle Paul speaks about this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. verse 16 and 17. 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 and 17. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. The Apostle Paul here mentions the coming of Jesus with a trumpet. And those that died in the Lord shall rise first. And then he mentions also the ascension of the saints. And here in Thessalonians, he does not give one detail that he gives in Corinthians. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 53. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. Those that were raised at the partial resurrection, they were not raised immortal. They were raised at the voice of God, glorified. And in Great Controversy, page 645, we read this. The living righteous, or the living saints, and what is the number of them? 144,000 in number. The living righteous, they are changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. At the voice of God, they were glorified. Now they are made immortal, and with the risen saints are caught up to meet their Lord in the air. So let us understand clearly the sequence, how it will happen. Paul says that those that died in the Lord shall rise first. That is the first general resurrection of all righteous. And when they are raised first, then we shall be changed. Those that will be alive, they will be changed from mortal to immortal, from corruptible to incorruptible. And then the two companies, they join together and they ascend to heaven. They will meet the Lord in the air. And remember that sister mentioned in Selected Messages, book 2, that sister was resting during the greatest part of the time of trouble. But just in the end, before the trouble was over, she was resurrected by the voice of God. And we have read here in early writings, page 16, that when many of the righteous dead were raised incorruptible, the 144,000 shouted hallelujah when they recognized their friends that were separated from them by death. Now, who are these friends? Remember, the first ones who died since 1844 died in the faith. They were sealed. And they will come up at the voice of God. But those that were not sealed from Adam until 1844, and from 1844 until the close of probation, they died not knowing the Sabbath, but died faithfully in that which they knew. They are not lost. In Great Controversy, page 449, it tells us that even among the Catholics, there are honest souls. They believe that Sunday is the true Sabbath, and God accepts their sincerity of purpose. If God accepts their sincerity of purpose, and if they die in that sincerity, they are not lost. But they are not sealed among the 144,000, because they did not keep the Sabbath. For example, we have the example of William Miller. William Miller, unfortunately, did not accept the Sabbath. And he died in 1849. And what is it that is declared about him, about William Miller? We read here in early writings, page 258. Moses erred as he was about to enter the promised land. So also I saw that William Miller erred as he was soon to enter the heavenly Canaan, in suffering his influence to go against the truth. Others led him to this, others must account for it. But angels watch the precious dust of this servant of God, and he will come forth at the sound of the last trump. William Miller will not come up at the voice of God, but at the voice of the last trumpet. Why? Because he did not take part in the partial resurrection. He did not keep the Sabbath. But he will be saved, even dying after 1844. Because he was faithful to the light that he knew. He will come up at the last trumpet. And then those that had been resurrected in partial resurrection, they will recognize their friends. Certainly, Ellen White, Sister Hastings, Nichols, they all will recognize William Miller because they knew him personally. And they will shout hallelujah when they recognize them. The Spirit of Prophecy tells us that we should endeavor to be among the 144,000 in Review and Herald, March 9, 1905. This is the counsel given us. Let us strive with all the power that God has given us to be among the 144,000. It is important that we may be a part of this number. If we do not have the seal of the living God, we shall be cut down by the destroying weapons. May God help us that we all may be among them. My wish and prayer. Amen.